It is my pleasure now to introduce the president of Quality Resteel, Inc., a great friend of Union Iron Workers, William Livingston. Bill joined the Iron Workers Local 426, Detroit, Michigan, in 1963. After becoming the owner and president of Quality Resteel, Bill continued his activities in the union as a management trustee of his local's funds and as a management trustee of the Iron Workers National Fund. He is presently chairman of the Labor Management Committee, working with Post Tensioning Institute to draft a certification program for iron workers placing post tensioning. He is a member of Iron Workers 25 Journeyman and Apprenticeship Training Committee and is also president of the Michigan Resteel Contractors Association and president of the National Association of Reinforcing Steel Contractors. It is my pleasure to present you today Bill Livingston, who will be escorted in by delegates from Local 25. Will the escort committee please bring Bill Livingston in? Let's give him a warm welcome. Brother Ironworker.
Entourage I had. Talk about being nervous. It's a good thing this podium is here, for without it I might not be able to stand here. It's giving me some support. You see, when I was a much better iron worker than I've ever been a speaker, and being an iron worker was much easier than being up here in front of you guys today. I'd like to begin by congratulating General President Hunt and all the other international officers on yesterday's election. I'm also offering these congratulations on behalf of all of the member contractors of the National Association of Reinforcing Steel Contractors. I might add that all of our contractors are union contractors. We employ only one trade, and that is the union iron workers. I would also like to thank General President Hunt for his kind and greatly appreciated invitation to address this assembly. I consider it a great honor to be here, and it definitely is one of the highlights of my entire career. As many of you know, because you've heard me speak before, when I address you guys being union iron workers, I sometimes tend to become emotional, and I hope I can control that today. But I consider it to be a great honor to be here, and it definitely is one of the highlights of my entire career. When I began my journey as a union iron worker in 1963, if someone would have told me that the road was going to lead to this podium in the year 2001, it would have been totally unbelievable. I've since come to realize when you begin a career as a union iron worker, you actually have no idea where that road is going to lead you. It might have many ups and downs and twists and turns, but I've also learned if a person applies him or herself, there are no limits, just vast opportunities waiting to be seized upon. I would also like to thank General President Hunt for his most gracious invitation and gracious introduction, but he unknowingly omitted my most coveted title, the title that is nearest and dearest to my heart, and that is the title of Union Iron Worker. There's a saying amongst us old Marines that goes, once a Marine, always a Marine. And I personally believe that same thing can be said about Union Iron Workers. For it's now been It's now been 28 years since I last strapped on my tool belt, but I'm still extremely proud to call myself a union iron worker. You know, I've never before been asked to, nor have I ever repeated a speech, but I'm about to. In July of 2000, at our school in San Diego, I addressed the coordinators and instructors from around the United States and Canada. I've since been asked by a number of people to repeat that speech today. Reluctantly, I've agreed to. I say reluctantly because a number of you have already suffered through it. If you are one of those who have, I ask for your indulgence. If you are not, well, I also humbly ask for your indulgence. I'd like to begin by going back a few years to 1956, when I was a young recruit in the United States Marine Corps boot camp in San Diego. I was required to sit in a class 1 hour a day, 5 days a week, for 14 consecutive weeks. This particular class was called the History and Tradition of the United States Marine Corps. All recruits were required to take this class, and many consider this to be the most important course a recruit received. This class was meant to instill a great sense of pride in the uniform of the organization and in the organization itself that all recruits were trying to become a member of. For you were not a Marine, you were only a screw, which is what all recruits were called until the day they graduated from boot camp and wore their uniform for the first time. While in this class, we were taught the history of the Corps, where it had came from, where it had been, its purpose and plans for the future. We learned about the responsibilities and privileges that came with wearing that uniform. We learned about all the hard-fought battles the Corps had fought and won. And we learned what it meant to be a United States Marine. On the day I graduated from boot camp, I realized I had earned the right to wear the uniform of the United States Marine Corps. And I had earned the right to be called the United States Marine instead of a screw. It was one of the proudest days of my life. I was now a full-fledged member of an elite organization, and I was filled with such a sense of pride, the sense of pride that I still carry with me today. Now I'd like to fast forward to 1963 and the day I was issued my first permit to work as a union iron worker. I actually felt like I had died and gone to heaven, for I had come from a non-union printing shop where I was earning $1.50 an hour with no fringes, to a job that would be paying me $4.10 an hour plus fringes. With this new job, I would now become a member of a first-class union organization, an organization that would teach me the needed and necessary skills to master a trade if I only applied myself, an opportunity to have a worthwhile, meaningful, and fruitful career. When I received my first 40-hour paycheck in the amount of $164, I was so proud of myself and that paycheck, I could hardly wait to get home and show it to my wife. When I did, I proceeded to tell her that she would never be able to spend all the money I was now going to earn as a union iron worker. How wrong I was. What I'm now about to say may sound very corny to many of you, but for me it was absolutely true. I was so proud to be a union iron worker. I was so proud of the job I was doing, and I was so proud of the uniform I was wearing. And I did consider what I wore, my boots, my Levi's, my t-shirt, my hard hat, my gloves and tool belt as being my uniform, the uniform of the union iron worker. Every time I strapped on my tool belt, I know I felt a little taller, and I know my chest became a little fuller, and everyone around me knew I was proud to be a union iron worker. I somewhat related it to the same elation I felt as a young Marine every time I put on my dress blues. Now my reason for bringing all of this up. I believe, and perhaps I'm a minority in my beliefs, but nonetheless, I believe that in our training centers around the United States and Canada, We do not spend enough time teaching our recruits, which is what our apprentices are, about the history and tradition of our union and our industry. Where we came from, where we have been, and where we hope to be in the future. I don't believe we place enough emphasis on the hard-fought battles that were fought and won or lost by the union members that came before them, about the sacrifices these union members made to obtain and secure the wages and fringes that today's members enjoy. I don't see the same sense of pride in being a union iron worker, the same sense of pride when strapping on a tool belt, the same sense of pride that comes from earning a living in this great industry that I saw many years ago. But I believe if we would spend more time teaching the history and tradition of our industry and our union to our recruits and spread it over their entire four-year apprenticeship, when it came time for them to graduate, they would proudly carry with them a sense of belonging, a sense of pride in the union to which they belong, a sense of pride in the career path they have chosen. For I believe when you have pride in yourself, your work, your union, and in your industry, you automatically become a better union member, a better, safer, and more productive iron worker, and a better spokesman for our industry. History and tradition, I hope all of our future apprentices are thoroughly knowledgeable in it by the time they graduate, and then perhaps we will never again see at one of our apprentice banquets, which is a banquet honoring our graduated apprentices, the indifference expressed by many apprentices at our recent banquet for them. They expressed their indifference simply by not showing up. It was an embarrassment for the members of the JAC, of which I am one. It was an embarrassment for the business manager and his agents, and it was also an embarrassment for our coordinator and his instructors. It was a far cry from the banquets we've had in the past that were standing room only, when all honored apprentices were proud to be iron workers, and they showed it. In closing, that's all of that, but last month in San Diego, I mentioned to General President Hunt that I would be pressing him to create a rod department within the International. And I don't know if he would... I don't know if he'll do that or not, but he assured me today that he would be placing a lot more emphasis on that portion of our trade, and he also acknowledged that more man hours are generated by that portion of our trade than any other portion. Thank you for your kind attention.